Welcome, everyone. I thank y'all for coming today. I also want to recognize I have council members Paget and Rivenbark that are with us here today.
And Sheridan.
And Sheridan. And Mr. Zappel is also here with us. Commissioner Zappel is also with us here today. So we thank you. You're going to be listening and hearing from several of our elected leaders here, Chairman Barfield, DA Ben David, Sheriff McMahon, and of course our police chief, Ralph Evangelous. We also have our city manager, Mr. Sterling Cheatham, here. We also have county manager, Chris Grudet, that's also here with us here today. So we are here today because we have had a serious problem facing our community, but we also have what I believe is a great opportunity. A great opportunity to continue coming together to find ways to reduce youth violence in our community. Just two nights ago, we came perilously close to having an innocent 9-year-old child lose her life while asleep in her bed at home. This senseless violence needs to stop, and we need everyone's help, prayers, and patience to put an end to it. Already, many of our local church leaders and other volunteers have stepped up to help, and I'm here today to ask for more of our citizens to get involved in our violence prevention efforts, and for more citizens to share critical information with our law enforcement personnel when violence occurs. While our crime rate has dropped dramatically over the last several years, we continue to face a recent spike in violent crime that impacts all of us, especially some of our most vulnerable citizens in our community. As I've said many times, and I will continue to say, this is not just a city problem or a police problem, it is a community problem. I implore all of our citizens to step up and help in some way. It is past time, but it is not too late. Having said that, your city government has put a lot of effort toward this issue over the last few years. Let me just name a few. We've created a mobile field force with our police department. We have created a new gang task force within our police department. Additional funding for more police detectives and more funding for the WPD's community outreach programs are just a few. As you may recall, we held a series of community conversations last year to get input from our citizens about this very issue. Hundreds of citizens were involved giving us input and ideas and asked us to, number one, keep our community centers open longer, provide more funding for local nonprofits that address at-risk youth, engage youth at earlier ages about education and career goals, and help in after-school and summer programs. We are doing just that. This council provided $151,000 in additional funding in this year's budget to help keep our community centers open longer and strengthen our partnerships with other nonprofits that provide services to at-risk youth. For example, we provided support for a new Kids Making It summer work program that employed at-risk youth over the summer. It wrapped up a couple of weeks ago with a very positive results. And just last week, we approved a contract with the Cape Fear Future Initiative to work with the Blue Ribbon Commission on the prevention of youth violence to continue and expand their very successful summer enrichment program for at-risk youth. We will continue to partner with New Hanover County Sheriff Ed McMahon and our District Attorney Ben David to go after criminals that commit crimes within our city. Their support and coordination is critical, and we appreciate them being here with us today. We also continue to work with our state legislators to support tougher sentencing laws for criminals who commit these types of acts and crimes, along with many volunteers and church leaders who have joined us to address this very serious issue. And I want to thank the men and women of the Wilmington Police Department for everything they do to keep us safe every single day. All that said, there is still more to do, and we need your help. Let us begin by hearing from the chairman of the New Hanover County Commissioners, Mr. Jonathan Barfield. Mr. Barfield?
Well, good afternoon. You know, last week or so, as I watched the news and recognized that a young man lost his life on Market Street, I pondered for a moment to think, what were his thoughts with the last few breaths that he breathed into his body? The thoughts of his mother and family members. Thinking about the young girl who was shot in the hand the other day as she was laying asleep in her bed, what are the thoughts that went through her mother's mind and her own mind as this tragic thing happened? You know, growing up here in Wilmington, this is not the Wilmington that I grew up in. Back when I grew up here, if I did something wrong at someone's home, I got a spanking at that home. A phone call went to my mom or my dad, and I got another one when I got home just to make sure that it was reinforced that bad behavior was not tolerated. As chairman of the Board of County Commissioners, I'm calling on every citizen in our community to lock arms, to hold hands, and indeed to take back our community, to stand arm in arm and to just have a voice and let folks understand that we're not going to tolerate the things that are happening here. We're losing too many young boys and girls in our community to senseless violence. And I'm calling on every citizen to step up. The county is indeed doing our part to bring more resources to the table. We're partnering with our school system right now and looking at ways to open up every one of our high school gyms starting next summer throughout the entire summer to give our young boys and girls another avenue, another place to come to. I've asked our Parks Department to build basketball courts within our county parks, again, to give our young boys and girls another avenue, something else to get involved in, partnering with our school system to indeed provide better educational opportunities to our children, whether it be the extended college program that we have within our school system, just trying to find ways to address the needs that they have. Working with people like Pastor Robert L. Campbell with the Rubin Commission on the Prevention of Youth Violence to give those boys and girls at DC Virgo an opportunity to see greater things, taking them on college field trips to open up their minds to new possibilities. As our mayor said, this is an opportunity. It's really an opportunity for all of us as citizens to come together. City government, county government, the police department, the sheriff's department, the citizens of this great community to stand with one united voice to work with our boys and girls. I'm encouraging every parent, every adult in our community to volunteer in our schools, to join the Watchdogs program, to let your faces be seen within our schools, and let these boys and girls know that you're standing with them at all times. And again, Wilmington, New Hanover County, we can do this. We can indeed make this happen. We can make our community the shining star that has always been in my mind, but what it was when I grew up here in our community. So I thank our sheriff, I thank our police chief, I thank our mayor, I thank our DA, the city council, the Board of County Commissioners, and all you all that are here standing up today to indeed bring a voice to this terrible thing that we're dealing with here in New Hanover County. May God bless those citizens that have been affected, and united we stand.
Thank you. Well, enough is enough. You know, yesterday I was dressing my three children to go off to their first day of school. And I was interrupted from that task with a call from our chief of police to tell me that there was another young woman, exactly the age of my middle daughter, who was not going to be going to school. She was going to be going to a hospital. Enough is enough. You know, there are some wonderful friendships up here before you. Without regard to political affiliation, we have done many things as elected leaders to try and come together around this singular issue. We recognize that there is no greater obligation and responsibility than to protect our young people, and wouldn't we all agree that the safest place for a child should be in their own home, in their own bed? And shortly after that, wouldn't we all agree that they should be safe in their schools? And so we have seen great things over the years. These partnerships have turned into things like the Blue Ribbon Commission on the Prevention of Youth Violence and the Hometown Hires efforts and so many other things that we could talk about today. But now we're calling on people beyond just those in the immediate law enforcement community and in the justice system. We're calling on pastors because we need your prayers, and we also recognize that many of the issues that we're confronting now, they're moral issues, they're not political ones. So we need to hit this head on. You know, verdict means to speak the truth, and we should be unafraid of the truth wherever it leads us, and that means sometimes confronting difficult realities in our community and in our world. Our children need us. They need our leadership. And that means that we need good people to come forward. There's only two ways to prove a case in the criminal justice system. That's through the introduction of physical evidence and through the testimony of witnesses. We will always do our level best to work with the professionals and the CSI units to bring forward those silent witnesses that scream the truth, like fingerprints, DNA, and ballistics. You saw those on full display in a trial I just completed a couple of weeks ago involving our young children, and you're seeing that across the street right now if you were to go back and watch the trial going on. But more and more, what we need is good people to stand up and say, we are not going to tolerate this in our homes, in our community, in our schools. So what we're really doing today is calling upon people for help. I know the fear that's out there. I have talked to you. I have listened to you. And I know that many people say, well, we can have a talk right now in this courthouse, but after the police leave, I still live in this neighborhood where all the violence is occurring. And so I know the chief and the sheriff and others are going to talk about how crime can be anonymously reported. And I want to stress to you that some of the biggest investigations that we've had, some of the biggest trials, have all started with a simple act. Maybe it's texting a tip up to a server in Canada that gets scrubbed of your information and beamed back down to the WPD. Maybe it's calling anonymously to a Crime Stoppers number and just to give us that tip that will get that investigation started, so that even if we don't get to meet you, I, as your district attorney, thank you. Because by letting that little light of truth come into the room, you're bringing hope to a desperate situation and you're bringing justice to our children. So if you know who did this one or any of the other crimes that we could talk about, I implore you, call those numbers, text those numbers. They are confidential. We fought very hard with our local delegation and our General Assembly to make sure that that is protected information and not discoverable in a courtroom. We're going to do everything we can to work with the people who are working with the people who want justice in this community. And I know 100% of us want our children to be safe. So our charge is to bring justice to this and every single case that the community reports to law enforcement. The truth will prevail. Let's look it square in the face. Thank you.
Sheriff McMahon.
Thank you. We as law enforcement, we're doing all the right things. And we're not going away. We're not going to give up. We're not going to stop. We're going to keep doing the things that we've been doing. And as been mentioned by our mayor, the challenges are turning into opportunities. And we're just getting more committed. And for the offenders, we are coming. We will arrest you. We'll do everything in our power to make the strongest case possible so our DA can put you away. For the rest of the citizens in the community, we need your help. We need for you to let us know, to give us information. We are here. It's our community. So let's take it back. And we are committed to continue doing all the things that we've been doing. We're not going away. So today, we're just asking for anybody in the community, come forward, give us information, help us, because together is the only way that we're going to really make the difference that we need to make.
Chief.
Good afternoon. Unfortunately, we're here once again asking for your help. First, I want to offer my thoughts, my prayers to the family of this little girl who was injured early yesterday morning, this drive-by shooting. I'm told she's doing well. She remains in the hospital after surgery. She was very disappointed that she couldn't go to school. She missed her first day of school. We have been in contact with her family and continue to check on her progress. We are committed to finding the individuals or individuals who fired into this home. And so today we are offering a $5,000 reward for the arrest of the suspect or suspects in this case. For anyone who gives that information, it helps us lead to the arrest of that individual. We're asking that if you have any information to call Crime Stoppers at 800-531-9845. That's 800-531-9845. All these calls will remain anonymous to us, but we'll work through the issues of the reward piece of it. Call takers are standing by right now, ready to take your information. If you don't want to call Crime Stoppers, feel free to text this information, to text a tip, by sending your tip to Crimes, that's C-R-I-M-E-S, then start your message with tip, T-I-P, 708. Please remember, all these texts are anonymous. The reward is made possible by the City of Wilmington and our Crime Stoppers of Lower Cape Fear. My thanks to the mayor, the city manager, Crime Stoppers, for moving so swiftly to pull this together. So what are we doing? What are we doing this with right now in our community? Our investigators are out as we speak, questioning individuals, trying to find as many leads as possible to lead to arrest in this situation. We've increased patrols throughout the city, partnering with our law enforcement partners, both in the county, state, and federal partners. We're putting together two campaigns, a crime prevention campaign to encourage the creation of more neighborhood watches. You know, when groups work together on the grassroots effort, things become much easier for us. If you want to start a neighborhood watch in your neighborhood, call 910-343-3945. That's 910-343-3945. We're also working with the Chamber of Commerce and our business community. They are committed working to try to address the issues of jobs in and around our area. In an effort to continue to build trust within our community, we're also launching a campaign to educate our citizens and our officers on what to do during a traffic stop. This joint campaign is being created by area law enforcement, our sheriff, and various other police departments in the area, and we'll be moving a video spot to be able to air on TV and over social media in the very near future. During the next few weeks, we are unveiling a community relations training program created by UNCW that will be offered throughout our city with law enforcement and the community members together. Stay tuned for dates and times and their locations. We realize we can't be everywhere. We don't have all the answers. But with your eyes, your ears, and your voices, we can end this senseless violence that's going on in our community. Remember, nobody wins when we keep silent. Now I'm going to ask Bishop Nesbitt, who's representing our clergy and our community, to come forward.
Good afternoon. The focus of our inner city clergy has changed quite a bit. In these recent hours, we spend so much time trying to find healing for these families, for these mothers and grandmothers, these fathers and grandfathers that have lost their loved ones, that our focus seems now to be on healing more than prevention. Please understand sometimes that our resources are limited. We do all that we can with what we have, and we just want to say thank you this afternoon because our mayor, our county commissioner, our police chief, district attorney, all those involved are saying they're willing to partner with us and be arm in arm that we might bring about a change. Please understand that a lot of what's going on is not just a lawlessness. There's a moral decline in our nation, and it's affecting everybody, as it's affecting Wilmington. But if we work together, those of us that care, those of us that love, we will rescue our children. We will decrease this senseless violence. As long as we have hope, we win. As long as we don't become overly aggressive because of anger, and we win. We have to keep a heart for those that are involved. We have to realize this is a small percentage, and this is not all of our community. We are banded together. There will be better days in Wilmington, and we are very supportive of the efforts that are going forth right now. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. I'd also like to recognize also that we have Pastor Campbell, that's also part of the Blue Ribbon Commission, has been with us from its inception. I also like to recognize our former council member, Ron Sparks, is also with us here today. And I want to thank each and every one of you for being here. This is an important issue for our community. It's happening, as the chief said, way too often. Enough is enough. As Charlie shared with me today, when do we say that? Enough is enough. And these folks can solve these crimes, but we're going to need the community to step forward and tell us who these people are and give us the information necessary to put these people in jail. People that are driving around this community that are shooting at people in broad daylight on Market Street, or shooting into occupied homes with many people, infants in the house, grandparents in the house, have a total disregard for the law, for civil society, and they don't need to be on the street. And if it happens again and nobody comes forward and tells who these people are, it may be one of your loved ones. It could be you. We need your help. And we need to put these people away as quickly as we possibly can. There are ongoing efforts. I know that we have folks here. We have Frankie Roberts here. We have Oops Foundation here. We've got different folks in the community that are trying their best to help improve the lives of our young people. But it's going to take time. There's a lot of issues facing our youth and our community. It's just not one thing. There's many things. It's we have experienced through the Blue Ribbon Commission in regards to education and health and well-being and a lot of other things. And these things are not fixed overnight. But we're going to need everybody's help in trying to help us get these people off the street as quickly as possible, because we've got some pretty bad people out there doing some bad things who have a total disregard for the law and for humanity in general. So I thank each and every one of you for being here today. And if anybody in the press would like to ask any questions, we're here to answer those. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. My name is Norbert Novak. I live at 907 Bonham. Recently, Mayor, within the past 6 weeks, my home alone was broken into twice. They broke in the middle of the night, about 5 o'clock in the morning. I'm legally blind, sir. You see from 30 feet, I see from 3 feet. They busted through my window, got and unlocked my window, unlocked my door, got a brand new flat screen TV that I just purchased for $380. I bought it on the 2nd of August. It was gone on the 8th. The officer asked me for the serial number. I said, wait a minute, I haven't even had a chance to throw away the box. 8 days later, this is the twice break-in. They've sold two motorcycles off my street alone. The children are putting some of the adults up to doing this. They're the decoys. They're watching, you know, when my roommate's there, when I'm not there. I've called the police many a times. They come out there, and I commend them for their job. I think the Wilmington Police Department do an excellent job. However, and I've called Leslie about the crime watch. Since the middle of June of last year, I made 5 phone calls. I've yet to get a return call. How much more can I do? My neighbors and I are ready to go with the vigilante committee, armed, take the old Wild West back. One of us is going home, if it comes down to that, and I hope it doesn't get that far. But so far, it's leading up to all indications that that's where it's going. If we have to be armed and dangerous, I'm in fear for my life, as well as my neighbors.
We appreciate your passion about that. We don't want you to take the law into your own hands. And we heard that comment today in the newspaper when I read the paper today, that this is a personal matter. You take things into your hand. We do not want our citizens to take the law into their own hands.
The police aren't doing it though, sir.
This is whatever we have our professionals here for, sir. And I will say, in respect to burglaries and stuff of that nature, the police chief has asked us for additional resources in respect to detectives. The city council has appropriated that money for this year's budget to hire 8 additional detectives to help them with a backlog of cases of Part 1 crimes that happens to be with burglary. So we have seen that, and we are addressing that particular issue with what the chief has asked for us from the city council, and we've been able to appropriate that
money. I believe it, sir, and I appreciate all the efforts you're making, but it just doesn't seem to be enough. On my street alone, I've been there for 2.5 years. Within the past 2 months, there's been 8 or 10 break-ins and burglaries. I mean, it's going to be dangerous. It's like, I'm scared for my life.
We appreciate your concerns. We're all concerned about this. And as soon as we can get these folks and get these people and put them in jail, we will.
It needs to be done.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay. Yes, sir.
Can you elaborate on the 9-year-old girl who was shot? And was that targeted,
or
was that part of the
gang-related violence? Chief, you
want to
say?
We don't know at this point. Okay, we're pretty blind in reference to what led up to this. We're not getting a lot of information coming to us, so we just can't answer that question at this point.
But the thing that concerns me is, and I think it was in the paper today, was the gentleman that I guess they interviewed at the house. They indicated that this was a personal matter. It's not a personal matter, it's a community matter. They may know who these people are. We'd like to know who they are. Because if it's a personal matter, it's become a community matter, it's become a city matter, it's become a county matter. And that person can get out there and hurt somebody else. It could hurt somebody playing in a park. It could hurt somebody just driving around when they get into a gunfight here. It's we've got to get these guys off the street.
Can I speak to that, Bill?
Yes, please.
You know, in the court, we talk about precedent and the idea that we have to remember our past or we're doomed to repeat it. I want to take you back just a few years to the first murder trial I handled here in this community. It was the murder of Demetrius Green. And I was so thankful to our members of the press who brought that case up just a few days ago for the lessons learned, because, of course, he was caught in a situation where his only crime was poverty, and he was simply going to Toys R Us in his mother's car when a stray bullet went down that street. When someone says this is a personal matter and that they should take the law into their own hands as a suggestion, I invite them to remember that case. Ty Baker was a victim of a crime. He had had $30,000 in drug proceeds stolen from his house. Sean Carter and Quata T Money, the two men who were running around this community doing 8 armed home invasions, many of which were unsolved at the time, had targeted him because he was a drug dealer from New York and had just turned a lot of profits and now had $30,000 in his closet. Do you think he reported it? No, he took the law into his own hands. It's called vigilante justice. The idea that today's victim is tomorrow's defendant, and you keep justice on the street instead of in the courthouse where it belongs. And so what happened was, is Ty Baker confronted Sean Carter and Quata T Money right there on 10th and Dawson in front of Johnson's Grocery. Shots rang out. Ty Baker was killed, so that was obviously a bad choice to not report the crime, but sadly so was that child. And that's when the community said, we've learned our lesson. Have we forgotten the lesson? Have we forgotten about little Papa? Have we forgotten about Demetrius Green? Because we just had another young lady about his same age who could have so easily been another victim of a murder. And it wasn't because of the mercy of a defendant that that didn't occur. It was just the mercy of a bullet going just slightly south of where it could have. We need to do better by our children, and we need to remember our history. I implore you now, do not try and take the law into your hands. Sir, I understand your frustration. I really do. Please leave it to the professionals. I agree, we need to do a great job at mobilizing the community around social media and with the neighborhood crime watches, and you're going to hear more from us in the days ahead on how we can do that. But with the folks who are most affected by crime, and I want to remind you that the highest crime areas are the highest victim areas, please report these cases. We can't help you unless we know who they are. And in a courtroom, we can't rely on hearsay. We have to have good people coming forward and reporting what they see. It's our community, we have to take it back. And only the community can do that. Thank you.
I've reported these crimes. They've got fingerprints, they've got whatever. Unfortunately, they're just not moving fast enough to satisfy my neighbors.
We understand.
It's banging on and on, and it's like going nowhere. Okay. We feel that we are not getting the response that we expect. We know we're not the only neighborhood in the city, but in the short 2 blocks, there has been probably, percentage-wise, 10 times the crime rate as the entire city
okay.
in the last 2 months. I mean, this is getting to be dangerous for us to even walk down the street.
Okay.
Where does it end?
Anybody else? Thank you, everybody, for being here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.